Thank you. Good morning and welcome. Chris just said to me, it's nice to hear the sound of voices. And I said to myself, that's because everybody slept for an extra hour this morning. You're looking very well rested and sounding well rested as well. So good morning again and welcome. We gather to worship the God of grace and the God of glory, as we will sing in a moment. And as the psalmist invites us to ask for a sign of the goodness of God as we gather as his people, as his community. And worship this morning. So if you would stand, Chris will lead us in our psalm of approach, and then Vicki will lead us in our opening hymn.
Please join me. Hear me, Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy.
Guard my life, for I am faithful to you. Save your servant who trusts in you.
You are my God. I have mercy on me, for I call to you all day long.
Arrogant foes are attacking me, O God. Ruthless people are trying to kill me.
But you, Lord, are compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness.
Turn to me and have mercy on me. Show your strength in behalf of your servant.
Give me a sign of your goodness, that my enemies may be put to shame.
For great is your love toward me. You have delivered me from the depths. Join me, if you would, in our prayer of approach as we say together, Glory to you, Lord God of our ancestors. You are worthy of praise. Glory to you. Glory to you in the temple of your holiness. For the radiance of your name, glory to you. Glory to you, beholding the depths in the high vault of heaven. Glory to you. Glory to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. Glory to you.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
be with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. As we consider what lies ahead for us in the days that are to come, we have a couple of meetings this week. Deacons will meet Wednesday night at 7. And then again, the group that gathers to prayer Friday morning at 8:30. All of you are certainly welcome to join in that. We do that one via Zoom. A couple of announcements in addition to what lies there. The Friends of the Council on Aging have a boutique that's going on today from 11 to 1 over at the Senior Center. They've handmade gifts that might be helpful to you in this upcoming Thanksgiving and holiday season. And all proceeds help programming for our Essex seniors. Also, just to let you know that Marietta Kamen, our longstanding sexton, kept this church very clean for lots of years, has determined that she can no longer keep going and has handed in her resignation. So we will be in need of new people to clean the church. If you have any leads there, please let Chris, the chair of our Board of Trustees, know. Or me, and then you might just drop Marietta a note thanking her for her many years of wonderful, faithful service. Are there other announcements to share? Craig. Craig would like to have coffee with you after church. So join him downstairs. He has provided goodies, and there is coffee also. Anything else? Then as we turn our hearts to prayer this morning, Dave Shorey is not with us this morning. He's had a bit of an attack of his pancreatitis, which comes every so often to him, and it's pretty painful from what I understand, so pray for his rest and recovery. David, if you're listening, we miss you, and pray for your good health in the days ahead. Jeannie Dorfman has asked prayers for a colleague named Karen who died this past week. She'd been suffering from a brain disease called glioblastoma and finally succumbed to that. Just hold her son, Spencer, and husband Dave in your prayers in the week ahead. Also prayers for a family in Essex, the Conrads, whose mother and grandmother, Edith, passed away this past week. And the kids grew up going to this church. We're part of the youth group when it was in the barn there. So just pray as they lay their mother to rest at Spring Street on Tuesday that the Spirit would be at work in their lives as they bid farewell to their mother. And then our missionary of the week, just to hold in prayer, is the Harbor Light Community Partners. Andrew DeFranza, ex-executive director, will also be sharing with us in another month or so. But just hold them in prayer as they seek to provide housing for vulnerable folks on the North Shore here of Boston. So let us bring these concerns and others that are on our hearts to the throne of grace as we join together in prayer. Gracious God, we do come to you as the God who is filled with mercy and compassion, whose love never fails, who enters into covenant with your people and maintains that covenant through his own mercy and grace. Lord, we pray that you would pour out on this people as we gather in your name, that you would pour your grace and your mercy, your glory and your power over us. That you'd fill us with wisdom and courage, and may that reign supreme over the fear and doubt that can creep into our lives. Pray, Lord, that you would guide and direct all that you would have us do and be as your church in this place. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Pray for those who are suffering loss this morning, for the family of Edith Conrad, for Karen's son and her husband, Spencer and Dave. We pray that your spirit of comfort, your spirit of hope, your spirit of resurrection would fill their lives as they celebrate and mourn the loss of loved ones in the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Pray for those who are ill among us, particularly for David this morning. May you continue to bring recovery to his body and healing to him, not only that he might go back to work this week, but be able to join us again as we worship next Sunday. Be with Wendy as she cares for him in the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift up the folks from Harbor Light Community Partners and the good work that they do on the North Shore here in providing much-needed housing for the vulnerable among us. Lift up the Anchor Point project getting underway in Beverly and for a project in Rockport called the Granite Street Crossing, which has now, Andrew says, received funding. So just in particular, sustain and guide those two projects in the months ahead. And bless Andrew as he prepares to share with us in several weeks. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you for Marietta and the years of faithful service that she has provided us and making sure that our premises are clean and safe and healthy. Pray for her next chapter in life and that you would guide and direct us as we seek her replacement. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Now, Heavenly Father, we add other concerns or celebrations that are on our hearts this day, voicing them either silently or aloud. And now we join our voices together and pray the family prayer that Jesus has invited us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Worship continues with the bringing of our gifts and our offerings and the gift of music that Vicki has prepared for us. Ushers, if you'd please come forward. Thank you. gracious God, receive the fruit of our praise this morning. Guide us and direct us as we use these gifts toward the furthering of your purposes here and throughout the world. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Boys and girls, you are excused for children's church, and if the rest of you would turn to your neighbor and offer him or her a greeting that is comfortable for you. Rhema must be in the house. Coming up on 2 years almost, hard to believe, that the pandemic began to shut things down. I remember two primary responses back in those days. From the extroverts among us, there was weeping. Having to live for an extended period of time without being around a bunch of other people to interact with seemed like a fate worse than death. But from the introverts among us, there was almost great rejoicing. Having to live for an extended period of time without a lot of people around them brought them hope. It seemed like a gift from heaven. Well, as the months went on, even the introverts began to sense a little bit of a need to be around other people. And in recent weeks, as folks have started to go back to the office or to the workplace, introvert and extrovert both seem to agree that maybe a couple of days back in the office with some other folks is not an entirely bad thing. Fact of the matter is that we are a people who need people. I should have written a song with that title, right? We need people because we have been created in the image of a relational God, of a God who exists as a community, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so as a people who are in his image, it shouldn't surprise us that we have this need for community. As we move along in our look at Ezra and Nehemiah, we'll see this morning two really wonderful pictures of community there. This, remember, is a book or two books that detail the return of God's community, Israel, from exile in Babylon, where they had been for 70 years. Beginning in the mid-6th century BC to the mid-5th century BC, they came back to the Promised Land in three waves, needing to regather and to rebuild and to restore their sense of what it meant to be a people of God in this new post-exilic reality that they were called to live in. What did being God's missional people look like in this day and age for them? A couple weeks ago, we met a fellow named Nehemiah, who led the third wave, the final wave of return from exile in 445 BC. And it was Nehemiah's call God had placed on his heart to lead the rebuilding of the walls and the gates of Jerusalem. Walls that had been reduced to rubble and gates reduced to ashes by the conquering Babylonian army several decades previous. And so, in the midst of this rebuilding effort, we see these two beautiful pictures of community. One in chapter 3 of the folks working side by side to accomplish one single purpose. And then in chapter 4 of them actually standing behind one another, guarding each other's backs in the face of opposition that had arisen to the rebuilding. So to get into these pictures and then to ponder what it is that they might have for us to think about, We'll begin at the end of chapter 2 with Nehemiah's arrival in Jerusalem and his looking about at the work that needed to be done. And that's where Chris will begin this morning.
Today's reading comes from Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 through 20. I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me, except the one I was riding on. By night, I went out through the valley gate toward the Jackal Well and the Dung Gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on toward the Fountain Gate and the King's Pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through, so I went up the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or the nobles or officials or any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble we are in? Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me and what the king had said to me. They replied, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. "What is this you are doing?" they asked. "Are you rebelling against the king?" I answered them by saying, "The God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding. But as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it." May God bless the hearing and living of his word. Now let us enjoy a moment of silent reflection together.
Amen. So when Nehemiah walks these streets of Jerusalem and sees the work that needs to be done and tells the people why he has come, what God has laid on his heart, and that the Persian king is supportive of this project, the people all declare, "Let us start rebuilding." And so the narrator says they began this good work. Might be worth thinking here for just a moment why this rebuilding of the walls and the gates was considered to be a good work. On the one hand, it makes sense that it's a protective, defensive measure. An ancient city put a wall around itself to ward off, or at least delay the attack of potential intruders. However, with Jerusalem, it goes a bit further. Jerusalem is the holy city. Jerusalem is the place where the temple of God is located. Building the walls around this city would have guarded this sacred space of the Lord, this space where he came to meet with his people. Having a gate and a wall that protected this temple would enable the people to worship and to offer sacrifice safely and in an ongoing way. Having a wall that was built and secure also said a lot about the reputation of the God whose city it was. If the wall was left in rubble and the gates in heaps of ash, this God would certainly not be thought of by anyone as being a refuge and a strength for them. His reputation would be one of disgrace, which is what the concern was here by those who saw the walls in this kind of shape. It's interesting, you might want to look later today at Psalm 48, as that psalm reflects on the beauty and the glory of Zion, the holy city of God, in its full array, so beautiful, so powerful looking, that the psalmist said it caused hostile kings to be astounded and to flee in terror. Wouldn't be the case if the city gates and walls still lay in ruins. And so the people, as they came to participate in this project, they had great purpose behind them, a great sense of wanting to rebuild these walls and the gates of the Lord's city, and they're coming together around this purpose. It was really a beautiful picture, although at first blush, chapter 3 doesn't seem to be so beautiful. It seems like a list of names that are very hard to pronounce and that it should be sort of back in an appendix somewhere. But it's right in the midst of the action. And so I'm going to read a little bit of it for you. I've made you read all the hard names so far in our study of Ezra and Nehemiah. I figure it's time I take my turn. So we're just going to read the first 8 verses of chapter 3. And listen for what you see here, what you hear here. Listen for the picture of this people as they are working on the walls. Eliashib the high priest and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. This is actually where the rebuilding started. The sheep gate was up to the north. It was right next to the temple. It's where the sacrifices were brought in to make at the temple. And the description in chapter 3 of this rebuilding goes in a sort of counterclockwise manner and comes all the way back to the sheep gate by the end of the chapter. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the Tower of the Hundred, which they had dedicated, and as far as the Tower of Hananel. The men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zakur, son of Imri, built next to them. The fish gate was rebuilt by the sons of Hassanah. They laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Meremoth, son of Uriah, the son of Hakaz, repaired the next section. Next to him, Meshulam, son of Berechiah, the son of Meshazabel, made repairs. And next to him, Zadok, son of Baana, also made repairs. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. The Jeshana gate was repaired by Jehoiada, son of Paseah, and Meshulam, son of Besodeiah. I still can't figure that one out. Besodeiah. They laid its beams and put its doors with their bolts and bars in place. Next to them, repairs were made by men from Gibeon and Mizpah, Melatiah of Gibeon and Jadon of Meronoth, places under the authority of the governor of Trans-Euphrates. Uzziel, son of Haraiah, one of the goldsmiths, repaired the next section, and Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made repairs next to that. Did you catch all the cool stuff in that passage? I sound like Ellie, our Sunday school teacher. She gets so excited about what she's teaching. It's such an exciting section of Scripture. You just don't know it, right? First of all, you've got just a huge variety of people doing work here. From the high priest himself, to his associate priests, to goldsmiths and perfume makers. And if you were to read on, you would see you could add to that various merchants, temple servants, and families with not only sons but daughters. 2 daughters are mentioned out there working on the wall. All in all, there were over 40 groups of individuals, but a really wide array of individuals at work here. Next to one another, 24 times or so that phrase is mentioned. Next to him, next to them, shoulder by shoulder, they were making sure that every inch of this wall was worked upon, and every inch was important. Didn't matter where you came from. There were some who were working on the wall who were living right next to the wall. There were others who were kilometers away, like in Jericho and Mizpah and Gibeon. This was the Lord's project. This was for the Lord's glory, and people came from all around for the opportunity to participate in the restructuring of this walled city. It's kind of fascinating when you think about it, and the wide variety of people. It reminds me of a Habitat for Humanity project, which has usually a great number of volunteers, most of them unskilled and unpaid, as opposed to a few paid professionals that are usually there kind of directing the work. But everybody has this purpose in mind of rebuilding or building this house so that a family experiencing homelessness can move in. Regardless of how trained you are, people are there, ready to go, ready to work. And that's the sense I get here in this picture. There was great unity of purpose and a group of people united in action, building up and rejoicing in the glory of God that this wall would represent. This was not, by contrast, as some have explained, what a football game is like, with 50,000 people badly in need of exercise, watching 22 people badly in need of a rest. This was every member ministry. All sorts of folks were involved. Virtually the whole community took part. The picture that we get in the New Testament of this is perhaps closely approximated by Paul's picture of the body of Christ, the picture of the church that he gives us using a human body. And his comment there is that every part of that body is important, from the nose down to the toes. And unless every part does its work, the body doesn't function as God desires or has called it to function. We also might think of the various one another commands we find in the New Testament, like encourage one another, love one another, show hospitality to one another, carry one another's burdens, bear with one another, forgive one another, have fellowship with one another. All of these assume that we're in some kind of community in which we can interact with one another and help each other grow into all that God has called us to be and help each other to accomplish what God has called his community of people, the church, to accomplish. To these various one another's in the Old Testament, we could actually add this one here from Nehemiah chapter 4, guard each other's backs. Because as the wall construction got underway, so too did the opposition. Because the enemy doesn't like it when they start losing territory to the Lord. And so the enemy here, represented by three regional rulers, Sanballat, Tobiah, and a fellow named Geshem, they threatened and bullied these workers to try and get them to stop. This one Sanballat is described in the text as being angry and greatly distressed. And here's his take here. What are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are? What they're building, Tobiah chimes in, even a fox climbing up on it would break down their wall of stones. Just kind of a sense of ridicule here of the folks who are trying to work. Emotionally abusive they were trying to be to these folks to get them to stop. But as chapter 4 has it, the people prayed, actually Nehemiah prayed, and the people continued to work. And then when the wall got to about half its height, the opposition kicked in again. And so the people now this time prayed, but we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. And then as the threat turned into a physical threat, Nehemiah got even more serious here about the guard bit. Half the people worked, and half the people he appointed to keep watch. And those that worked, if they had to carry something, they'd carry it with one hand and they'd have their sword in another. It's a sad picture that it had to happen, but in a way, a beautiful picture of this community watching out for one another and making plans to keep one another safe so that the work of God could go on, could continue. It's also a fascinating picture when you think about it of prayer and action at work that helps us avoid a couple of pitfalls we can have. want us to think that the job that is at hand is just so important and it's going to take so much of our time and energy that we just don't have time to pray. Now, these folks prayed regularly. The other pitfall is that we could say, well, I'm just going to pray because God's going to bring it about, so I don't really need to do anything. I'll just sit back and watch. There's no sitting back and watching here. They prayed and they worked. They prayed and they posted a guard. And so the work was able to continue, and eventually it was completed, chapter 6 reveals to us. So, two lovely pictures, I think, of people working side by side to accomplish the purpose that God has laid out for them, and the people guarding one another's back to keep them safe and healthy and secure. There's a bit of a third picture in here, which is kind of a sad one, actually. We read by it. I just want to go back to it as we bring our comments to a conclude this morning. Conclusion. It's in chapter 3, verse 5. It talks about some folks who didn't want to participate in this community effort. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. Not sure why these folks decided to sit this out. Scholars surmise it has to do with pride. Putting your shoulder to the work was an agricultural term that described oxen being hitched to a cart, and when applied to humankind, it's not a very flattering picture. It says, no, I'm too good for this here. But the greater question is, what did they miss by not participating in this community effort, this community action? To this end, I was intrigued by a cover story that appeared in Christianity Today last month entitled, "Empty Pews Are an American Public Health Crisis." It's in the October issue. If you want to check it out, I'm just going to sort of skirt over the conclusion that the authors made. The authors are two folks from Harvard University. They work in a project called the Human Flourishing Program. And in the article, they're amassing really a number of studies that have been done in recent years about the effect of declining church membership on the health of people. And the conclusion is, and continues to be affirmed with each successive study, is that declining church attendance is bad for our health as a people. But conversely, regular participation in a worshiping community leads to greater life expectancy, less depression, suicide, smoking, substance abuse, and divorce, better cancer and cardiovascular disease survival, and more volunteering and civic engagement. It's not that we decide to come to church because we want to make sure we don't have to go to the doctor. It's not concluding that if we just praise God enough that God is going to bless us. But it is revealing that this network of social support that we enjoy, the clear moral guidance that is laid out for us, the relationships of accountability that are a part of our life together, and the sense of purpose and hope that participating in a relational community that is connected to the relational God of resurrection can't help but be good for our emotional and physical as well as our spiritual state. And like these nobles of Tekoa, if we don't participate, we can't benefit in what God has for us as his community. To be sure, we've been through some trying months, months of exile, we might even say, months that the pandemic has forced us to worship apart. But that's not God's ultimate desire for us. I don't see anywhere. His desire is that we be together because we need one another. We are a people who need people. And not only do those two pictures from Ezra and Nehemiah, I think, depict that for us, but I'll conclude with an encouragement from the writer to the book of Hebrews, the New Testament book called Hebrews. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. And so as we come to the table of the Lord this morning, we come to celebrate the family into which God has called us, and the healing and the well-being that being a part of that family can bring. Amen. And so as we come to this table together, the family table, as it were, let us rehearse the great story of which we are a part, as it is sketched out for us in the Apostles' Creed, speaking these words of faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so as we come to this table, we come to the place where Jesus was sharing the meal, turned out to be the last meal of his life, with his followers. The Passover meal in which they look back to God's rescue of his people from slavery in Egypt. And Jesus used the elements of this meal to point to a greater rescue from the slavery of sin that he was about to bring about for them as he went to the cross. And so during the meal, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. My brokenness to meet and heal your brokenness. Eat this in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup and said, "This cup represents the new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The Apostle Paul writes, "As often as we share this bread and this cup, we proclaim the death of our Lord until he returns again in glory." So let us together proclaim this mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. And let us prepare our hearts to receive this meal that Jesus has laid out for us through the confession of our sin. Let us join together and then spend a moment in silence. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy upon us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. And now, having made our confession, join me in the declaration of good news. The Lord is risen and reigns over all. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And so we'll receive the meal this morning by a modified form of intinction. You'll come forward, and as you've been doing the past few months, take a piece of bread from one of our deacons and then move over and take an individual cup. And we just ask that you take the bread and eat it while you're here, and same with the cup, and there'll be a basket that you can put the cup in before you head back to your seat. Vicki will lead us in worship and song as we join together in this family meal. And so I invite you now to come forward and receive the gifts of God given for the people of God. Feed on them in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Let us join together in our prayer of thanksgiving. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you have graciously fed us with your amazing love and have called us to live within your family of faith. Spur us on with love and good deeds that we and those around us may know the life-giving power that is the community of your people. Amen. And the community of this people has a story to tell that Vicki will help us to sing through as we close our time together this morning. Thank you. Now, as you go from this place, go with these words to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all that we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, both now and forevermore. Amen.